Color is a definition of how we perceive the reality, those tones that brings us joy and fulfillment. But are you the type of person who wears colors on your day-to-day life? Well, let's find out. There is no secret, Mido is gaining popularity today. That happens because they started to look in the rich past, realizing what they did across the history and came back to the current audience hunger for vintage reissues, with certain answers. Now, if I step aside and look at the entire Swatch group, I might say there was a massive strategical move here, where every brand started to revive their iconic old-timers. As examples, the Certina DSP H200M, or the Super PH 500M, the Hamilton Intramatic Chrono, or the Mido Ocean Star Tribute, and many more interesting timepieces are showing us their interesting designs today. And if a few episodes ago I was nostalgic, trying to seek in myself a reason, trying to find an answer to the question why I released the Ocean Star Tribute, motivating myself that someday I will have the chance to meet it again, today I'm happy, just because the most iconic Mido, probably, but certainly the most colorful watch, found a home on my wrist. As I said, Mido has an interesting, rich history, and they were specialized to make instruments out of watches. And in the 30s, the brand released a revolutionary concept named the Multifort, a shockproof, water-resistant and anti-magnetic watch. That, believe it or not, was Mido's first watch to feature a self-winding movement, in the same year introducing the case sealings and the crown gaskets. Still in the 60s, when officially the relics of the World War II were transitioning feature-wise from field watches to waterproof watches with immersive features, Mido came up with a multi-purpose design that had three essential roles: to be waterproof, to tell the time, and to display a chart. Translated, they introduced to the market the Ocean Star Skin Diver watch, the Powerwind 1000, that had a waterproofness of a diver, obviously the ability to tell the time, and a decompression chart that allowed the divers to know underwater for how long they need to decompress before they reach the surface. And honestly, I have no idea how the watch was welcomed back in the days, but nowadays I can tell you that the watch is haunted by the collectors. A good condition one can be sold for the price of a Daytona. Still, a promise is a promise. After the overall presentation of our 2020 release, I will show you how the decompression timer really works. It took me a few hours to figure it out how it works in multiple contexts. Also some insights compared to the Ocean Star Tribute, so stay tuned. So, the Ocean Star Decompression Timer 1961 is combined from two major designs. Once, it borrows the overall dial layout of the original one, having the decompression table, the numerals in the center, the loom pip, the minute and the second hand, but contrasted in black. I'd say not to scare the audience from the beginning. They were looking for a safe contrast, black instead of white. The second point, the Ocean Star Decompression Timer borrowed the case of the Ocean Star Tribute, actually sharing the exact case, the same finishes, the same bezel and the same rotating mechanism. And I don't see a problem with that. I mean, I love the Ocean Star Tribute, but they even kept the same sets of lug holes, the Tribute version needing the extra holes to fit the Jubilee bracelet on it, keeping the same lug width at 21 mm. So yes, we are talking about a case that measures 40.5 mm in diameter and 13.5 in height, sitting really comfortable on the wrist due to the lug-to-lug reduced size, concluding that the chassis of the decompression timer or the Tribute is quite a valuable design for us. And because of the crown guards and the pronounced bezel, as I said a few episodes ago, it brings a Rolex Milsap vibe on it. As for the crown guards, they look like a bird beak that holds a seed in its mouth. It's really cool. But the piece of La Resistance seems to be the well-articulated crown, sized perfectly, outlined by grippy coinage strips, and signed with the vintage Mido logo. Makes this crown probably one of the best I've ever seen or felt. Movement-wise, Mido is solid. Why? Because Swatch own ETA, and most likely every brand under its umbrella has the latest calibers. This one housing the Mido Caliber 80, which is ETA based, obviously an automatic with 80 hours power reserve. And if I'm not mistaken, this movement equips the latest Certina divers as well. Dial-wise, if the Ocean Star Tribute had a simple but an effective design, the decompression, I might say it's busy but with an increased level of investment on the materials. An effective reason is the polished Mido Vintage logo that increased the character and the identity of this watch. It really complements the reference of the 61 model. The unusual polished hands work in perfect balance with the logo. I've never seen on modern watches a severe contradiction of the hour hand with the minute and the second hand. A small hour hand shaped in an arrow, trimmed inside to host Superluminova. And the long thin minute hand that contains as well a thin bar of lume, balanced with the needle second hand. Being on the same uncommon thread, the lumed rectangular bars as well, unusual for modern reissues. The lume is, as the vintage incarnations launched recently, not that potent. For example, neither the Ocean Star Tribute, the Doxa Sub 200 or the Oris 65, they all suffer of the same uneven lume. Still, what is great about it, the tiny numerals inside of the black area are lumed, and they are quite visible at night. And I think I've never seen such small lumed numerals. Another interesting accent is the conic date shape, this time being made somehow to be blended with the decompression table. And last but not least, the decompression table, and as it is showed, is differentiated through colors, which should represent the Nitrox dive table. Everything described in box into a sapphire crystal that distorts the dial when angled, complemented by the uncommon bezeled markers and the oversized lume pip, which I like a lot, being quite tired to see the same cliché with the triangle at 12 o'clock. What is important and wanted to highlight, besides being a regular watch on the surface, underwater it transforms into a timer, meaning that the minute hand needs to be resetted at the start of the decompression table, at 12 o'clock. So if you're interested to know how much time left until Oprah starts, you will need to wear a regular dive watch as well. Now, I'm pretty sure not everyone knows what the decompression is and how does affect our body during diving. Well, as you descend during a dive, the nitrogen you're inhaling dissolves into your body tissues like sugar into a cup of tea. This is called on-gassing. So when you spend time at depth, the gas enters the bloodstream via the lungs. Here it dissolves and then diffuses into different tissues. When you ascend, nitrogen diffuses back from the tissues into the blood, where it is perfused back to the lungs and breathed out. And this is known as off-gassing. So how much and how fast you on or off gas depends on multiple factors. So I spent a few hours to figure it out how this watch works. And essentially the minute hand, yes, should be resetted at 12 o'clock before the dive to enable the calculation. So the funnel at 12 o'clock represents the depth ascending. On the left hand side we have the meters and on the right hand side the feet. So every depth value has its own track and based on time spent underwater at specific depths, you need to make decompression or not. As an example, if you are diving for 40 minutes at a depth of 35 meters, here indicated by the pink track, you need to make decompression for 40 minutes, which means to ascend to 5 meters below the sea to decompress. And if you want to know why the bezel has the minute markers descending, it's because it can be set to know how many minutes passed since you've started the decompression. But if you want to do repetitive stops underwater for decompression, you can use the lume pip to know when you started and every time transpose the total spent time counted from 12 o'clock once again. So brilliant, but not easy. It took me a couple of hours to understand and to validate the numbers looking at decompression tables. They should have added a manual in the box, or maybe it's there, but I've never checked it. And speaking about the box, the watch comes with the Milanese bracelet, and between ourselves, I would have preferred the bracelet from the Ocean Star Tribute with the folding clasp feature. And besides that, it comes with two more straps, a leather one with colored stitches that connects very well with the colorful dial, and a fabric one, I'd say, with yellow stitchings that as well connects with the dial color palette, and complemented by some beautiful Mido signed buckles. So to recap, the decompression timer is a watch on land that transforms its functionality into a timer underwater. It has a courageous design that brings a lot of elements from the 60s in our days. The logo is sensational, bringing a lot of character on the crown, on the dial, the case back, and on the clasp. After all, Mido redesigned probably their most interesting watch developed all time, so why not making it right? And yes, sadly, I've overpaid for it, but I'm glad I own it. And surely will be qualified as the 10th brief beater on the channel, because it has a rich identity, history, brand philosophy, and a reliable movement. So I think since we reached the first 10 brief beaters on the channel, I think it's worth visiting the Hall of Fame and present them on a separate video that will be launched this weekend. So stay tuned, because it will be awesome. So hope you enjoyed this video as much as I did. And if not, please let me know in the comments down below, how can I make it better? But still, if you're passing by, please consider subscribing for future creative updates. And until next time, stay safe.